In the same year, a reversal of fortune had seen a new look Human League finally get in on the pop action, partly thanks to a lineup change that took them out of the pages of the Enemy and put them on the front page of Smash Hit.
We got Joanne and Susan simply because we were booked to do a European tour, and Martin and myself became unable to be in the same group, and we just thought, well, got some nice high vocals, yeah, let's try a girl. Let's be a bit different and try a girl. And from that, the step was that if we were going to take a girl on the road with a load of terrible randy idiots like us, there ought to be two of them to look after each other. And Joanne and Susan turned up. I was being sarcastic there, by the way. We were sitting there reading books, really.
Oki spotted the girls dancing in a futurist nightclub in Sheffield.
Our parents thought there's some ulterior motive, something's going on. But then Philip came round and met both sets of parents, and they thought he was a decent enough guy. And then we went to school with our parents, and they talked to the head teacher, who thought that it would be good for our education to have 6 weeks going round Europe, because we could go to art galleries and things like that.
We never went to said art galleries.
We did go to a lot of clubs.
Yeah. We went to Cologne Cathedral too. That was about the most cultural thing we ever did.
It also meant that we could appeal to women as well as men. The early Human League was a very male-based group, and really only lads in long coats liked us. And some transvestites.
Okay, pop music, let's go! Anyone here like a Human League?
Released in 81, Dare crystallised the new synth-pop sound.
We did something that could only be done at that stage. While we were doing it, they were bringing the machines in that enabled us to do it. For instance, the very first Lindrum, I think, that arrived in England, came into our studio, and we took the drums off sound of the crowd and put the Lindrum on. And without that, probably it wouldn't have worked.
I mean, I remember when Martin Rushent got the Lindrum, and it was like a child at Christmas getting, you know, the first fire engine or something, and he was jumping up and down, and all the boys were, you know, like, oh, it's a drum, you know, because before that, apparently the drums had been one of the hardest things to do, and now there was this box that was sort of this big, and you could program it, and they were all very excited, and we were a bit like, okay, boys.
Now the floodgates were open, the rush to market swept every aspect of British life in the early 80s. Everything was now up for grabs, including pop music. In an attempt to eclipse his ex-bandmates, former Human League member Martin Ware would cash in on the times with a concept album.
We were doing the day shifts, they were doing the night shifts in the same studio. They were making Dare, we were making Penthouse and Pavement. I've never been so motivated in my life, believe me. I said, we're going to make it stylish, fantastic. Finally, the shackles are off. We can start using other instruments because it's, you know, the original manifesto is broken. But we're still going to make it predominantly electronic. And so the idea was that suddenly we're not a group. We are ripping open the facade and going, no, this is great music, but it's a business. It really is a business. doesn't matter, Bob Dylan can sing all he wants. He's busy brown nosing the A&R man behind the scene. Now here comes my job. But ironically, and we were totally anti-Thatcher and always have been, you know, fascist groove thing, etc. It got taken on board by the aspirational yuppie culture in the early 80s as their kind of theme tunes a lot of the time, like Let's All Make a Bomb. They completely missed the point of the song, totally, and it's like, yeah, mate, oh, I remember listening to that, yeah, Braces, it's fantastic, mate, love the ponytails.